Welcome back to our final lecture of this week. Today we'll be discussing the attack by the Japanese on Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941. This is probably, up until 2001, the most famous day in recent American history as far as a specific date goes. Of course, we've got July 4th, 1776, the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Most Americans knew that date. But I would say until 2001, for Americans that lived after World War II, December 7th, 1941 was a day. Unfortunately, it was not a positive day. In fact, to quote one of the most famous of our politicians on that day, it was a day of infamy, or a day that would live in memory, but not for good reasons. That's what infamy means. It's the opposite of famous, in a sense. Famous is usually positive. You're famous for good reasons. Infamy is famous for bad reasons. Now, the attack on Pearl Harbor needs some explanation because, in many ways, especially in the manner in which we have talked about the World War II conflict, it very much seems like a surprise attack. And it was a surprise attack, don't get me wrong. It was surprising that Japanese warplanes flew over Oahu, Hawaii, and attacked it, don't get me wrong. But it wasn't exactly a surprise in the sense that it was completely unanticipatable by anyone in the United States. There were a lot of events going on in Japan and the Pacific that were pointing towards a conflict between the Japanese and the Americans. Now, not the specific attack, although actually the United States did have prior knowledge of the attack. We'll talk about that a little bit later in the lecture. But there certainly were indications that the United States would be dragged into a conflict with the Japanese. So to understand that, we need to go back, talk about Japanese, really all the way from 1855 or so until 1941. You'll remember that when we discussed the west coast of the United States and the opening of California, specifically during the Gold Rush, we also mentioned very briefly that the United States needed somewhere to sell their new goods, specifically all that gold. And one of the markets that they opened up was Japan. Commodore Perry sailed his fleet over to Japan and basically forced his way in and said, "Japan, you're trading with us on threat of we'll shoot you if you don't, or we'll shoot your government officials so we can trade with your merchants." And Japan wisely chose to engage in trade with the Americans. This is oftentimes called the opening up of Japan to the West. In other words, Japan's borders had been closed for approximately 200 years before this point to Westerners and Western innovation, and after 1855, the floodgates open and Japan has access to the West. And Japan, unlike most other Asian nations, rapidly adapts to the Western way of thinking, the Western way of life, and that happens in a number of ways, only a few of which we're going to be able to detail in this short lecture, but it's something that's certainly worth your time to study if that intrigues you. The Japanese are going to immediately modernize their education program. In fact, they're going to send many of their young men and young women to Western schools to learn, not only to the United States, but also to Europe. And these young men and women would come back and they would revolutionize the Japanese education system. They would bring modern European ideas to their country, ideas about science, ideas about technology, ideas about managing a nation, and all of these ideas would flow into Japan and Japan would adapt them, but in many ways, Japan begins to resemble the West. They act in a Western manner, they have the military power of a Western nation, and in many other ways, they begin to resemble the Europeans. In fact, this process is so intense and so impressive that by the early 1900s, specifically the years 1903 through 1905, the Japanese successfully fought a war against Russia and won. And this is the first time in recorded history that an Asian nation dramatically defeated a European nation, at least in the modern era. We're not talking about the ancient era. There's really not enough contact between Asia and Europe to warrant any real conflicts between the two. But Japan wins a war against Russia. This, at the very least, announced to everyone in the world that Japan was a power that needed to, at the very least, be accounted for. It had the ability to project power. It had a very good navy, which of course makes sense. Much like Great Britain, Japan is a series of islands. Okay, and of course a series of islands has to be controlled by the water, and so Japan is naturally going to be pushed towards naval power, and eventually in World War II it's going to be pushed towards air power to keep its island territory. Now, Japan had been busy acquiring territory that was not occupied by Europeans to bolster a problem that Japan had in the modern world economy, and that was a very limited number of natural resources. Japan, to rectify this problem, had gone about acquiring several different pieces of territory. The first piece that they acquired was Formosa. You will know that as the island of Taiwan, which is a large island off the south coast of China. If you're not familiar with it, I encourage you to look it up. They also acquired the Korean Peninsula, and of course you're familiar with both South and North Korea. Korea was unified under the Japanese, so they possessed the entire area there, and they mined Korea for resources and other things like that. Finally, the Japanese went on to push past what today is the North Korean border and into the northern regions of what is now China. This area was called Manchuria, and it was generally controlled by China, but it was taken from them by the Japanese. And this area also began to be integrated into the Japanese Empire. But Japan still had several problems. They had found enough iron to produce their own steel, but they didn't have enough steel to supply the kind of heavy industry that Japan wanted to invest in. And they also didn't have access to any native sources of oil. And this was a significant problem. In fact, by 1940, Japan had to import more than 80% of its oil from the United States and approximately 18% of its oil from other foreign sources, which means, if we do our math quickly, that means there's only about 2% of the oil of Japan actually comes from Japan itself. And of course, 2% of their oil supply wasn't going to last them long at all. In fact, the Japanese military commanders told their government that if the oil supply is cut off to our nation, our armed forces will grind to a halt after about 9 months. Another resource that the Japanese badly lacked was rubber. And you might think of rubber as something that is not all that important. In fact, the only thing that you probably think of when you hear rubber is tires, but rubber is used for a lot more things than just the tires on your parents' vehicle. It's used for almost every moving part of your parents' vehicle. It's used on almost every appliance in your home, and it's used for your shoes. It's used for a huge number of industrial products. It's really hard to run a modern country or a modern business without making use of a rubber product in some way, shape, or form. Now today, it is possible to create synthetic rubber, although synthetic rubber is actually less good than natural rubber. You might not know that natural rubber comes from trees. Specifically, it comes from the latex tree. And you might be familiar with the term latex that's oftentimes used to describe certain types of rubber. And again, there are other types, but again, most of those are synthetic, although there are a few other trees that can grow rubber in much smaller quantities. The problem is that almost every bit of rubber in the world came from one of two places. Option one was South America, but that rubber was almost entirely controlled by the United States and the native countries of South America, which did not trade heavily with the Japanese. The other option was the French colony of Indochina, which is modern-day Laos, Thailand, and Vietnam. And those nations also controlled a very significant, and I should mention Cambodia as well. Don't want to leave one of those countries out. They also controlled a large amount of these rubber trees and could produce industrial levels of rubber. And so Japan really had two issues. It didn't have enough oil to fight a long war. It didn't have enough rubber to fight a war. Now, why this mattered and why there was a potential of the United States cutting off Japan's supply was in 1937, the Japanese again felt it was time to expand their territory. And one of the reasons they thought it was time is because the Chinese government was being broken in half by inner conflict that was going on in China itself. And this conflict was primarily between the communist Chinese, led by Mao Zedong, and the nationalist Chinese, led by Chiang Kai-shek. Chiang Kai-shek is the man that would go on to be the ruler of Taiwan and would lose the war, and Mao Zedong and his communists would actually win the war after World War II. So that isn't something that we'll be able to talk about today. But the Japanese sensed weakness, and in 1937, they claimed that the Chinese cavalry, and you heard that correct, cavalry, Chinese soldiers armed with pole arms and mounted on horses, attacked a Japanese army outpost by crossing a river and massacring several Japanese soldiers. Now, the Japanese were a fully modern military unit. They had machine guns, airplanes, and tanks, and they claimed that Chinese people on horses rode across the river to go attack them. I think not only do we think that's ridiculous, but almost everyone involved in politics at that time thought that excuse was ridiculous, and yet the Japanese used that as an excuse to invade China in 1937. In fact, the Chinese lost badly to the Japanese for the first 2 years of the war. The main reason for this is the Japanese simply completely outgunned them. The Chinese simply had no access to weapons that could damage the Japanese, and the Japanese had been preparing for this attack for decades at this point. The Japanese landed at more than 10 major invasion zones and quickly pushed in on China's coast. In fact, if you look at a map of China in 1939, you'll see that the Japanese controlled almost the entirety of the Chinese coast, although a minority of the Chinese land area. You might think to yourself, oh, look, the Chinese have a lot of land left to them after this Japanese attack. Why couldn't they fight back? Well, the reality is that most of the usable land in China is actually on the coast and between the two largest rivers, the Yangtze and the Yellow River, and that is where Japan quickly took over and took control. In fact, in 1938, one of the most infamous moments of World War II occurred, and that was called the Rape of Nanking. And the reason it's called the Rape is because it was the utter destruction and pillaging of the Chinese capital, which at that time was at the city of Nanking, or Nanjing, depending on how you want to say it, not the modern Beijing, which you're probably familiar with. And the city was put to the torch. It was destroyed. Estimates range from 300,000 to 1 million Chinese people were slaughtered in less than a week. This is a amount of people killed in the level of some medieval attacks, and this level of barbarism had really not occurred in the modern era. And the reason for this is a deep ethnic racial hatred between the Japanese and the Chinese. Now, all of that is important to understand because in general the United States favored China in these conflicts, especially when in 1911 the Chinese had overthrown the last emperor and declared themselves a democracy or a republic. Now, in reality, the Chinese were not a democracy, even under the nationalist Chinese, who we tend to think of as the good guys versus the communist Chinese. In reality, it was controlled by a military dictator. But the Americans viewed this Chinese state very, very favorably. And there was this idea around, and you guys are probably familiar with this idea, that China was the underdog getting beaten up by the big bully Japan. It's the same reason that some of my friends like to root for whatever team is expected to lose in the Super Bowl. They say to me, oh, wouldn't it be nice if this team that doesn't have much of a chance goes and they beat the other team that's always winning every single year, right? I had some friends rooting against the Golden State Warriors last year or 2 years ago when they had won a whole bunch of championships in a row. They were rooting for the other team, not necessarily because they liked the other team, but they were rooting for them because they were beating the big guy, the guy that had won every time. And I have several friends who root for teams just because they can beat the Patriots or something like that. We oftentimes like to root for the underdog when we are rooting for teams. And I think in some ways the Americans were doing something similar to the Chinese. The Japanese seemed to be just bullying them, and obviously then there was this massacre at Nanjing, and so the American public highly supported the Chinese in this war. And two things come about because of this. Number one, some Americans were so adamant in their support of China that they actually left the United States and took some planes and began flying combat missions in Japan. These guys are called the Flying Tigers, and they're quite interesting. If you've never heard of the Flying Tigers, they're certainly worth your time to research and read a little bit about. But the other thing that happened is a really strong pushback against the Japanese government. In fact, the American general public pressed FDR and his government to reprimand the Japanese in some way. And the United States used a technique that it now uses very, very commonly, and that is economic sanctions to attempt to stop the fighting in China. Effectively, what the United States did was this. It tried to, maybe blackmail is the wrong term because I think the United States was in the right, but it tried to manipulate Japan by withholding certain resources. Effectively, what the U.S. did is it said, Japan, we are going to put a quota on the amount of steel you can import. And this quota was very low, much lower than the average or the annual Japanese purchase of steel. Effectively, what this would do is it would force Japan to do one of two things. They would either have to fight a war with less resources, meaning they have less of a chance of winning, or they would have to end the war, negotiate an end to the war, and go back to buying their full allotment of steel. And the Japanese generals were very aware of their own resource shortages. This steel reduction by the United States would mean that new military production for Japan would end in 10 years. And I know that sounds like an extremely long time, but the United States could maintain this sanction against Japan. And in 10 years, where would Japan be? Japan imagined itself expanding for a long time. 10 years, while it seems long to us, was actually a amount of time that the Japanese were very concerned about. This pushed the Japanese to begin thinking of other places they could get resources from. They began to look towards other options, and two main options really occurred to them. Number one was they could attempt to push north into Russian Siberia. Russian Siberia is incredibly resource rich. It has a huge amount of oil. It has a large amount of steel, iron, gold, and other resources. The problem is that the Japanese did not think they stacked up well against the Russian army. There was a border conflict between the Japanese and the Russians in 1939, and the Russian main battle tank, the T-34, something we will talk about in one of our in-class discussions, I don't think this week, but this coming week, was incredibly effective. And in fact, many people regard it as the best model of tank developed before the war for World War II. It was incredibly good at what it did. It was not the best tank in every category, certainly, but considering the Soviet Union was able to produce 70,000 of the things, and they were, without a doubt, one of the best tanks of World War II, it's not surprising that they were able to easily handle the Japanese. The Japanese tank corps was very, very poorly equipped, and this shouldn't surprise us. Again, the Japanese are primarily interested in their naval forces and in their aircraft. They're not investing heavily in their army, especially when you're fighting the Chinese, who, remember, are mounted on horses. You don't need very good tanks to fight people mounted on horses. So the Japanese throw out the idea of pushing north against the Russians. Now, those of you who are familiar with your World War II history might ask this question. Germany attacks Russia in 1941. Why didn't Japan add on to what Germany was doing and attack Russia from both directions? And unfortunately, I don't have an answer for you for that. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I guess I should say, for us, the United States and Russia and Britain, the Japanese instead chose the southern option, which eventually brought them into conflict with the United States. In fact, if you ever play a war game of World War II, the most famous of which is Axis and Allies, normally if the Japanese and German player collaborate and attack Russia at the same time, Russia oftentimes collapses before the United States can do much to win the war, and this oftentimes leads to a Japanese and German victory. Not necessarily an American and British defeat, but the Americans and British without Russia were going to be in an almost impossible situation for actually winning the war. And to explain the depth and the exact nature of that would take me a series of lectures. And unfortunately, this is a general American history class and not just a World War II American history class. Man, I wish I could teach that. But unfortunately, we can't go into that much detail. So for whatever reason, the Japanese excluded going into Russia. And even in 1941 June, when Operation Barbarossa, that was the German invasion of Russia, got off, the Japanese never revisited that plan. They never considered invading Russia. And again, why they did that is known only to the Japanese high command. They never wrote it down, and they never told anybody. And it's almost guaranteed that that was the wrong decision. They should have attacked Russia and not gone south. But they went south. That's what they did. And history deals with what happens, not what could have happened. And so we need to discuss that. As the Japanese went south, there were two primary areas of resources that they were interested in. The first was French Indochina, and the second was the Dutch East Indies. Now, the Netherlands had a functioning government in London, and the United States actually specifically stepped in and guaranteed Dutch colonies. The Netherlands had been conquered by Germany, as had France, for the record, at this time. But because France's government, you'll remember this from last time, had actually switched sides, it was technically a member of the Axis powers, the Japanese decided that attacking the French colonies would probably not prompt a response from either Britain or the United States. And by the way, the Japanese were somewhat correct in this. There was no military response. So Japanese troops poured into French Indochina, easily got rid of the French troops, and occupied the area. This gave them a nearly unlimited access to rubber, which was one of the two resources you'll remember that they needed badly. The Dutch East Indies, by the way, contained huge quantities of oil that they wanted. The problem is that the United States did, in fact, respond for this seizure of French territory, and in a way that Japan did not expect. The United States said, Japan, we are going to not only sanction you, we are going to blockade your access to steel, oil, and rubber. Effectively, you are now cut off from trade with the rest of the world. By the way, this wasn't just the United States. The United States also told South American countries, you may not trade these things to Japan. So effectively, in early 1941, as Japan is invading Indochina, they find themselves completely cut off from all other resources. This prompts the Japanese Admiralty to write the government and say, we have less than 11 months of oil left, all right? First, we were talking about a span of 10 years. In 10 years, the Japanese war machine would grind to a halt. Now, admirals are telling the government in 11 months, every Japanese plane, tank, and battleship will stop moving because it is out of gas. And we can't really build more ships. We don't have enough steel. And even though we've captured rubber production, it's going to take us a long time to begin extracting the rubber. If we are stuck like this, it is very possible that our war in China will have to stop and we'll have to negotiate with someone. And of course, that might lead to losing Indochina. So this was a serious problem. Unfortunately for the Japanese and for the brave American men in Pearl Harbor, the Japanese decide to try and fix this problem from a military perspective rather than from a diplomatic perspective. The Japanese high government, there was a council of six individuals that kind of led Japan. Specifically, the leader of this group is a guy by the name of Tojo, T-O-G-O. They decide that the best way to move forward is a surprise attack on the American naval base in Pearl Harbor. Why would they choose to do this? Well, the answer to that is fairly simple. They hoped in one single overwhelming strike on an enemy that was not prepared for it, they could knock the United States out of the war. Now, that phrase is often thrown about, and you might ask, what does that phrase mean? Well, here's what it means. The Japanese hoped that by destroying Pearl Harbor and the fleet within it, that the United States literally would not have enough fleet power to oppose the Japanese in the Pacific. And because they couldn't actually fight a war, they would instead agree to a peace treaty, and they would again sell oil and steel and rubber to the Japanese, just like things had been in the past. Now, you might see the absolute flaw in reasoning here. Why would the United States sell to a nation that had attacked them with no warning? And to that, I have no answer. It doesn't make sense. Not only does it not make sense, but it didn't make sense to a number of Japanese ministers who were in on the plan. They said several times to the government, guys, this doesn't make sense. If we attack the Americans, they're not going to sell us anything. Okay, that doesn't work. That doesn't make sense. We wouldn't sell them anything if they attacked us. They're not going to sell anything if we attack them. This is silly. And yet the Japanese high command decided to go along with this. And on December 7th of 1941, they do. The Japanese sent a large carrier squadron, this is several aircraft carriers in conjunction with more than 1,000 airplanes, to a position due west of Pearl Harbor. And the plan was to launch the planes, and the first warning that the airbase there at Pearl Harbor would have was their appearance on radar. And those planes would immediately seek to blow up as many American fighter planes as possible and to destroy as much of the United States Navy as it could in Pearl Harbor. Now, the unfortunate thing is, and this has led to several conspiracy theories, is that the United States actually did have some information that this attack was going to occur. There was rumblings that the Japanese were considering a military attack. This could have come at Pearl Harbor. This could have come at Singapore or Darwin, Australia. So there were several options for this attack, so I don't think that's enough information to go on. But actually, on the evening of December 6th, the morning of December 7th, a telegraph was received from Japan that basically detailed the plan of the Japanese to attack Pearl Harbor. And unfortunately, this coded message came in, and the person who received the coded message could not break the code that was in on it, and he instead, not knowing it was an emergency, sent it by normal means to the guy who was going to do the translation and decodification of it. And unfortunately, the guy who did the decodification of the message got the message decoded 30 minutes after the first plane appeared at Pearl Harbor. So the information to warn the men at Pearl Harbor existed. Unfortunately, because it was in code, it literally could not be used. Now, some people have taken that to claim that President Roosevelt was aware there was an attack coming and he didn't warn anybody because he wanted to join the war against the Germans. I don't think there's any substance to that, but some people do believe that conspiracy theory. If you ever hear them talking about FDR knowing about Pearl Harbor, that's what they're talking about. They think that he knew about the telegraph and he purposely had all of those American men killed to start a war. Again, I disagree. I am not Franklin Delano Roosevelt's biggest fan by any means, but I do not think that he allowed those American men to die without cause. And I don't think he knew about the attack ahead of time. Now let's talk about the attack itself. The attack itself was brutal, and it was devastatingly effective. The Japanese had several very high-tech warplanes that were really more than a match for anything the Americans could bring, and they attacked from complete surprise. In fact, December 7th happened to be a Sunday, and so many American airmen were not working. It was a weekend. They were having a good time. Some of them were at church. I would not describe the base at Pearl Harbor at any state of readiness whatsoever. And so when the warplanes came in, their two objectives were to destroy the American fighters and to cripple as much of the American Navy as possible. And they did both extraordinarily well. Japanese planes strafed the landing fields. Many of these landing fields were chock full of planes. Men had been out washing their planes. They had been doing maintenance. The runways were not in a state that would allow fighters to take off easily. And the Japanese were effectively able to drop bombs and fire on these airfields with complete ease. And it was kind of like shooting fish in a barrel. These planes couldn't go anywhere. They were sitting on the airstrips, and it's oftentimes been said in modern war that the best place to destroy enemy airplanes is on the ground, because they can't move, they can't dodge, they can't do anything to fight back. They're just sitting ducks. And of course this is true, and many, many Americans are killed in these attacks, blown up, lit on fire, horrible, horrible things, as they attempted to get as many planes as they could either into safety in the hangars, which wasn't much good because the hangars collapsed on top of them, or tried to get them in the air. And unfortunately, very few Americans were able to get in the air, and the few that did were oftentimes shot down by Japanese planes. So there was really no victory for these Americans trying to get into the planes. The Japanese attack on the ships was also devastating. In fact, more men died in that attack than died on the attack on the airfields. The Japanese were using dive bombers and torpedo planes, and the torpedoes were really what did the most damage to the American battleships. In fact, when you think of a combat warship, any hit that occurs above the waterline at the end of the day is relatively superficial. It is damaging, and it could impair that battleship's ability to fight back. Certainly a hit on a turret of a battleship might prevent its turret from working correctly, but really anything above the waterline is not all that damaging. What's really a problem for a naval vessel is any hit that occurs below the waterline, because of course that allows water in. And of course we've talked in class specifically about the Titanic, about the bulkhead system that all large ships have. They have internal compartments that can be closed down. Torpedoes make very large explosions. Sometimes it's hard to understand how devastating a single torpedo hit can be. And these torpedo hits blew huge gaping holes in these ships, and they were lightly stabbed. And so even though there might have been bulkheads that would have kept several of these ships afloat, there weren't enough men on them really to do anything about it. And so more than 10 U.S. battleships and dozens of smaller U.S. ships go down to these torpedo bombers and dive bombers, and more than 2,000 Americans are killed in less than 2 hours on December 7th, 1941. Now, as you might know, and as the Japanese immediately understood, this attack was ultimately a failure. And the main reason it was a failure was because the most important part of the American fleet was not in Pearl Harbor, and that was its core of aircraft carriers. The United States, on December 7, 1941, had three functional and one nearly functional fleet carrier. These carriers, which we will be studying intensively because of their absolutely critical role in the defense of the United States against the Japanese, were the Enterprise, the Lexington, and the Yorktown. These are the three carriers that existed at this time. The almost complete one was called the Saratoga. None of these carriers happened to be in Pearl Harbor. They were all out on exercises, training maneuvers outside of their home base so their crews could get more used to sailing them. The Japanese, when they returned to their carriers and headed back towards Japan, as they gave their mission briefings, immediately noted that there were no aircraft carriers present when the harbor was attacked, and the Japanese admiral in charge of the attack immediately said that our mission has failed. Because while neither the Americans nor the Japanese understood how pivotal aircraft carriers were going to be, both sides did have an inkling that the war for the air was ultimately going to determine the war for the seas. And this is true far more than anyone, I think, on December 7th, 1941 is going to understand or comprehend. Because it turns out that the aircraft carrier effectively transitions the world into a new era of naval warfare. And this era of naval warfare is one dominated by the airplane. And that is going to be the story, by the way, that we discuss in our next lecture, The Miracle in the Pacific. The story of how the Japanese went from having six aircraft carriers to an American three aircraft carriers to two American aircraft carriers to a single Japanese aircraft carrier. And again, we've talked about these resource shortages of the Japanese. The Japanese needed to win the war and needed to win it quickly. And the fact that Pearl Harbor had failed already put the first nail in the Japanese coffin. And the Miracle in the Pacific, which we will talk about next time, next week, and if you've seen the movie based on that event, the Battle of Midway, you might already understand this. The Americans are going to be able to produce unlimited amount of ships to fight the Japanese with, something that the Japanese simply could not do and never had a chance of doing. That's going to wrap it up for this week. Hopefully you've enjoyed learning about World War II. Pearl Harbor is a very important day. In fact, it's a very important date, in my opinion, December 7th, 1941, one you should remember. December 7th is technically Pearl Harbor Day. It's not necessarily a federal holiday, but it is a day that we should recognize the sacrifices that the men and women of the United States made from 1941 to 1945. So, very important one. Obviously, not the day you're watching it, but something that you should always think of every December 7th. I encourage you to think of the brave sacrifices of the men and women at Pearl Harbor, not expecting to be attacked on that Sunday morning. But eventually, those who survived and the many people that joined because of this underhanded attack would eventually defeat the Japanese and the Germans, and that is the story that we will continue over the next few weeks. Have a great weekend.